Hi everybody, I hope you got back from lunch well and now not having a food coma. To get you up to speed, we are starting with Peter, who is telling us a bit about BGP and how it could be used for preventing spam, or better saying, for distributing white and blacklist of IP entries.
All right, thank you. Yes, my name is Peter Hessler. I am with the OpenBSD project. This is a side project that I've been running for a couple years now. So before I get into what my project is solving, I want to talk about what other methods are that exist in the wild already. So for most people that run an email server, you want to block spammers and block various entities that are sending you things that you don't want to receive. And sharing this information is very helpful. So there's been two traditional ways of distributing this information. The first one is just there's a file on a website, you fetch it, you add it to your configuration, and you periodically refresh this file. It's a very common method, it's very old. Most people run this at the very top of the hour, and so that means everyone who's fetching this file fetches it at the top of the hour. And the web server that's hosting this gets completely overloaded. Sometimes it falls over, sometimes it doesn't. And then after about 1 minute after the hour, nobody touches the server again until the next hour. And generally what happens is that you get out of date pretty quickly. A spammer can start sending spam at 20 minutes past the hour, and they have 40 minutes until everyone updates their lists. The other method that exists is where you query some service. This is traditionally a DNS, a blacklist, and when you query it, your performance is as fast as they are. If they take 300 milliseconds to respond to your query, then your email server, it will be delayed by 300 milliseconds. And for one or two emails, that's not a big deal. But if you're processing hundreds of emails per second, that adds up very, very quickly. The other problem we saw, and we saw this when Spam House was DDoSed off the internet, is what happens if they don't respond to you? And during that incident, there was quite a few entities that just simply rejected all mail as spam because they couldn't talk to Spam House. So this is a network-based spam fighting tool. We are using a tool, it's based upon a tool from OpenBSD called SpamD, which is a very straightforward gray listing daemon. And then we use BGP and BGP communities to distribute those addresses to all the listeners and all the ones who want to subscribe to this. It is not content-based. My service has no interest in whether or not you want to enable macros, if you're interested in Viagra, or anything else. This is, you put it in front of your content because you know for a fact that these guys are bad, so why bother? So SpamD, because it's a gray listing service, it has the built-in ability to import and export whitelists, blacklists, and even what hosts are being graylisted. BGP is designed to distribute routes from one router to another. And as a bit of trivia, you can specify individual hosts, individual IP addresses as a route. IPv4 to /32 and IPv6 /128. And so we're just combining these two. For those of you who are not experts in routing, I'll give you a little bit of background on what BGP is. It's the glue. This is probably the single most critical piece of technology on the internet today. If BGP doesn't work, you can't talk to any other network. The entire internet backbone depends on this. It is incredibly fast. It scales incredibly well. We've had 20 plus years of experience with it. And it has a thing called communities, which is just an arbitrary tag that you put on a route. And it just means whatever you want it to mean. So as I said, we just have these attributes. We mark it. In this case, we have a route 192.0.2.55. And we've marked it with this community, which is displayed as two 16-bit integers, 65066:42. the way communities are generally done is that it's your AS, which is your network, colon, and then some value. And in this case, I chose 42 because it's good. So I use it. You're probably already using various blacklists from third parties. They've already done the work to identify that they're bad. If they're bad to you, they're probably also bad for you. And they're probably also bad for me. So let's just share this. That's also interesting for a whitelist server. Do I reasonably trust this? Do they generally send me good email? That is also very interesting information to share. The other thing that this provides is it helps you avoid the traditional Gmail problem, where Gmail will just retry from just random IP addresses and will never actually successfully connect through a gray listing service because they haven't retried from that IP address. If other people already have them in their whitelist, then this is just distributed to you as well. So we only want to add addresses that do something, only the ones that actually did it. We don't want to penalize the neighbor. We're basically out of IPv4 addresses. You don't know who your neighbor is going to be. Is the other entity a spammer? Is the other entity a good actor? Who knows? Why should you be punished because of who your neighbors are? So we just want to be simple. Like, those who are very, very bad, block them. Those who are likely really good, we'll give them a bypass through a few of your first levels, the fences. You still want gray listing because gray listing is still really helpful. So how you get blocked is essentially you've never communicated with that server before, and that server sends an email to a poisoned address. This address has never been used for good. It's never been used for anything. And they just, for example, just send an email to sales@yourpersonaldomain. You don't do sales, so it doesn't exist. And it gets added to the blacklist. The bypass list is a bit more complicated because generally you just get in by retrying sending an email. Spammers have gotten clever over the years, and now they retry occasionally. So if we're just distributing that, then that's not going to work out so well. Pulling numbers out of the air, we decided 75 days is good enough. They fall off after 36 days or so. And if they sent me 10 emails, yeah, sure. Why not? There has been no science at all put into that. That's an artistic statement. I am running the service available for you. Configuration examples are described on the website. You can download them and start running it yourself. And what it does is just pulls the IP addresses down to your local system, and then adds it to either your whitelist or your blacklist. Updates are sent essentially instantaneously. It's about 1 second for every client machine to receive the update. And when I was doing testing over, you know, my crappy slow home DSL line, I would get the full table in well under 7 seconds. So getting the full update is extremely fast. And since it is it's a dynamic update system, as soon as it's known, it gets added. So I've been running this for about 3 years, or about 4 years now. It was launched at AGBSDCon 2013. At the time, it was just small, 3 servers, and then by the end of the day, I had 4 total users, which is not bad for a service that kind of only makes sense on your actual email server. A couple days ago, as I was on my way here, there's now over 400 users of this, IPv4, IPv6, 2 servers that you can fetch data from. One is based in California, and one is based in Germany. This started off just as a pure experiment. I had no idea if this made any sense. Would this work? turns out it seems to be interesting. A number of people told me their spam load's gone way down. Email from known good people that they haven't talked to before has gotten faster. For some of these people, the Gmail problem has kind of gone away. Gmail's not the only entity that does this. Also, quite a few other email providers. Basically, we need for the system more of the more source servers, more servers that are sending me, are making decisions whether or not things are good or bad or whatever. And then there's more development work that I can do to make this a more kind of a faster system and kind of extend out some of the features. Since we're just tagging them with communities, we can also do things like, oh, they've been port scanning me, add them to the list, or SSH knocking, trying to get access to SSH or bad logins or something. For now, it's been focused primarily on only their behavior over email, over SMTP. I've had a number of people helping with this. Bob Beck from the OpenBSD project helped me write the original paper and validate the original ideas. I've had a number of the three main sources right now are myself, Henning Brauer of a hosting company in Germany, and of Peter Hanstein, who is a consultant and author. The hosting is generously provided by SonicNet in California and my current day job, host server in Germany. So, just a brief overview of what it is. If anyone has any questions, we currently have plenty of time.
Yes, we do. You were lightning fast. Are there any questions?
So even though while this was developed on OpenBSD, it does work with any BGP speaker you can run on any system. Some of the people using it are using Quagga or Bird or ExaBGP or whatever, and they feed it into whatever their preferred gray listing daemon is, postfixes. Even a few people are inserting it into their own DNS RBL for their own private use. So it's just a method of just distributing addresses, and you can utilize those.
Cool.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, second round of lightning talks. May I introduce you to Edmund Rogers, Big Easy, a fellow researcher in the energy field.
Oh, it's magnetic. So you put it right next to my pacemaker. Thank you very much.
Here, what?
Can I turn it? What?
That's a bit far off.
To hear
your lovely voice.
They need to hear me better. How's that? So how are we doing on time? Let's see. My talk starts in...
You have 22 minutes.
I have 22 minutes. And a 20-minute talk. And...
Right, 2 minutes for questions.
Yeah, there's 2 minutes for questions. So you want me to do 20 minutes. Well, let's see what's on the screen. Ooh, there's no internet connection. Isn't that just sad? So the demo's not going to work. I forgot to set the demo up because it requires an internet connection to load up in real time here. God damn it. Under pressure, turn away like a blind man. Yes, I just used LS in a Windows box. And I can also do DIR. So we're going to let this thing This is a very difficult process here. All right, so we'll let that go. Now, let's see. What's this talk about? Quality issues, why not? Because I never really got to make slides. I apologize in advance. Oh, this only has two slides. This is not the right one. Oh, here we go. So is this actually being filmed?
Yes.
All right, so we skip through all of this stuff because that is not to be filmed. We could start here, maybe. Sorry about that, guys. You should have been in New Zealand a few weeks ago. You could have gotten to see those, or you can see me later. Hi. So, like you said, I'm Big Easy. I'm Evan Rice. I work during the day at the University of Illinois, as some of you may know, because I've spoken here previously and done training. And I do research on the power grid, specifically in critical infrastructure defense. Now, I didn't know whether or not I was going to have a two-hour talk or a 20-minute talk when I was accepted at Troopers, so let's see what we can do in 20 minutes. So we know about, you know, SCADA building, sound infrastructure, and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, you want to be able to audit, trust, but verify. This is a theme of Troopers. And how effective is the current best practice, you know? And then in terms of power utilities, we have this idea about compliance regulations and this idea about that, you know, actually reviewing the number of assets that they have is not necessarily need to meet these compliance standards. So it's really knowing how many assets you have is not really a high priority. So providing security measures is very, you know, to be able to provide security measures for things when people don't know how many things they have is very difficult. And, you know, so syslog is predominantly used in the industry to put things together and maybe figure out what's going on in an industrial control system using flow data and maybe going out and doing sensor data. And there's a lot of challenges. But, you know, there's a lot of stuff in there, not just security events involved in data flows coming from out of ICS, because there are these things that are like maintenance and the idea in America where power is in the market and it's being bought and sold in 15-minute increments and day ahead and things like that, and then outage information and things like that, which are have valuable information. So it's a very challenging thing to put all these things together and also provide a comprehensive view of the system. So I was involved in a research project called CYPSA, which is basically cyber-physical situational awareness for specifically, we started the research out in the power grid space. So there's lots of universities here. I work at the University of Illinois. I think of Gabe's here. He works there too. Oregon State, Rakesh Bulba, and Rutgers, Fitzsimon. And we're funded by the U.S. Department of Energy. This is originally it was under the Office of Electrical Liability. And then we were funded under ARPA-E, brought out this tool for cybersecurity and situational awareness and power grid. And with the talks being filmed, I really don't have much comment to make about the status of the ARPA-E funding at this point. But right now, I think, so this kind of research that we did has been funded down to zero in America as of the 2018 budget as put by our president. So just for like a little 5-minute review of, so this is what US is not paying for anymore. So this is the research team. You gotta watch out for this guy, especially him. Whenever you see this guy wearing a suit, you know, something might be wrong. So so maybe we should redact that slide. So I talked a little bit about this problem already, but the cool thing about this is like, you look at things like there was a blackout in America, if anybody can remember, back in 2003, where 20 million people lost their electric power. And this is kind of like the power flow diagram for the Northeast outage in 2003 that affected, I think it was 20 plus million electric customers and maybe 24 nuclear power plants, among other things. And anybody know or heard of a city in America called Cleveland, right? So Cleveland is right here. Near the Lake Erie, and So this was the linchpin of the entire outage. And one of the things we were doing when we were doing research is considering the facts that what if there was more situational awareness so that when this operator is in a situation where he has to make a critical decision about whether or not he's going to black out Cleveland to stop a cascading outage, which is a significantly large city in America. And you have 5 minutes to make this decision, 10 minutes. So you need to dump an entire city in 10 minutes. So this is the decision you have to face. So in the true fashion of being able to make a delayed decision never gets anybody fired, the outage ended up going around this Lake Erie and just basically knocking out northeastern United States, including things like cities you might have heard of, like New York City, perhaps, and things like that. But from a research perspective, we're looking at, like, so if we could take and look at the electrical engineering model and superimpose the actual equipment that comprises itself of the model, it would be an interesting research thing when you took the and take a look at mathematics, where if you look at a power flow diagram, everything, when it's in a steady state, is nice and level. But when there's a perturbation on the grid, we have this situation where the grid goes a little bit off the reservation, and we have this perturbation back to normal. So, and then the time scale's kind of like with the cycling. So this is like something that we want to see happen in a situation within 20 milliseconds on a particular piece of device. So it's pretty fast timing to come back to steady state, because if it goes too high, we have a problem where this is all fucked up and bad stuff is happening now, because this is never going to converge back to a steady state. And kind of like in the tool, so the idea is like, yes, we have these situations where if we can model impact or power flow, we want to be able to put a seam between the cyber, cyber meaning computer networking components, IP addresses, things like that, and physical location along with impact at that time. So in the power grid, we make this calculation, or we're shooting for a calculation every 15 minutes. Because this is where, in the United States, the power grid makes state estimation determinations within every 15 minutes. That's our standard bearer as well. So instead of trying to be NP complete and computing this on the entire power grid, we use what computational power we can bring to bear and come up with a list of the top N assets. And this is based on two things: impact on the actual power grid, and a cyber security score that's based on NMAP and vulnerability scans and all of these traditional things where you can come up with your own scores and things like you might have seen at Troopers Research in the past. We put those two scores together to come up with a rank. And then right now the rank is it's a research issue where it's a project in motion. So we come up with a rank list. We provide you with the top N and assets. And we try to keep things from, like, the lights from going out, like in the 2003 blackout, because we want to be able to enable operators to make decisions based on the best information that we can give them in near to real time for a human being. So there's electrical engineering slides in here. I really don't have a lot of time to talk about, so I'm going to skip through some of this stuff, because we want to get to the sexy stuff, right? Because we want to collect and manage inventory data. So if you look at things like, anybody here, there was a power outage in the Ukraine recently that was caused by hackers. Did anybody hear about this? Anybody? Maybe one guy? So yeah, so in my world, the Ukraine power outage was really a watershed moment for a lot of folks in critical infrastructure, because you had a moment where it was said, we have an adversary who's gotten into an HMIR, human-machine interface, in a control center by remote means, and he's taken over the screen, and he's clicking on things and turning things off. So it's an interesting use case, because what we can do in simulation now with this kind of tool is say, oh, so what happens if this particular IP address the device gets compromised, what kind of impact would that have on this operating machine? And this doesn't necessarily have to be on the power grid. The stakes are just a lot higher. This would work in other industrial control system environments that have machines that are running that perform certain functions and produce equipment. They just have timescales that are perhaps not as quick as 20 milliseconds, but it could be costly if there was downtime, right? So we've been playing with the ideas, like we can assign things like, oh, instead of impact weighting based on blackouts, we can do things like cost of outage, and then give you a ranked list of cost of outage things. Because, oh, by the way, this is open source, so you can go in and play with the engine yourself. There's XML templates so that you can build your own ranking system and use our engine that was developed under this research project to do your own top ends. And then, but in terms of use cases that we came up in the research for this whole idea I was already talking about, asset ranking, top end assets in a certain amount of time. And then like in the control panel, kind of looks like this. And then one of the use cases that came up that was interesting was patching. So when you have thousands of devices and then a limited time window when these things are actually down, you want to be able to prioritize your patching, because what do you patch first when you have to patch 10,000 things and you have 20 minutes? Right? So the idea about the use case is, where do I patch first? So what we did was two things. We built this interface where we could tell you where the most important impact things were for patching, and then provided in the interface a little box that says, oh, by the way, I patched this. Now recalculate everything and let me know what's on the top of the list. So you can actually come up with, because perhaps what's most important is different if once you patch number one. It might not be number two anymore. It could have been number five, but now he's floated up to number one. So you can get like a list that's ranked on what your patching order is. And then this whole idea about aggregate exposure. So the idea behind this is, say that I want to know how many Great Scott Gadget devices I might have running on my network at revision level 3.21. But if I have no idea what's in my inventory, I don't know what my exposure is, because I don't know how many of these devices I have on my network, that's handy. But I can go in and say, oh, what I want to know is what's my aggregate exposure? So if all of these things get compromised, because I can make an assumption that if there's a vulnerability, all of that similar item might all go out tits up at the same time. And maybe like you look at an example of this might be, there was something called Stuxnet. Does anybody remember Stuxnet? I mean, I don't know how the display in German. Anybody Stuxnet? All right, so a few more hands come up about Stuxnet. So Stuxnet's a case like for aggregate exposure. If this person that was, who shall remain nameless, this anonymous operator somewhere, gets hit with the Stuxnet thing, but he does this aggregate exposure study on the impact of his industrial control system operation. He can see that he has an exposure where these centrifuges all have similar levels of either equipment or operating system, and he can weigh the impact of what happens if they all go up at the same time or are misused, and then what would the impact of that be? So you can kind of see that being able to do this on just from our perspective in the power grid is like, you know, the power goes everywhere. There's thousands and thousands of substations, and you're going to be able to figure out ways of coming up with planning for things that are unexpected, because maybe they only happen infrequently, but you want to be able to build a plan for what happens. So then if something were to happen in there, you can just go in and do some cyber incident planning and say, what happens if this guy gets in here and we have this case of an aggregate exposure, and we can see that there's certain lines that, oh, this one, then you kind of can't really see it on the screen, but it's at 126%, so that's bad. You know, generally speaking, an electric wire, you don't need to be an electrical engineer to know that if it's running at 126%, that's probably really bad. So I did actually zoom in on this, so that's bad, okay? You don't need to be an electrical engineer for that. And then kind of like just putting the pieces back together, and this idea about this host is compromised, and then the question is line K at risk? and which hosts can be compromised to kind of put line K at risk. And this can all be modeled so that we can see whether or not we have a steady state or if we have something bad. Ooh, wait, I'm going too fast now. Or maybe I'm... So this is kind of like when we open source this, I did a talk at B-Sides, and you can kind of like look it up. Because the idea behind this talk was like to just give an introduction to the research to see how it might be received by a European audience, because we released this and there's like a slide with the actual where the software is, but what you're gonna get is kind of like maybe what I can demo depending on how much time I have left.
5 minutes.
Oh, it's not bad.
Including questions.
Oh, well, so this is the slide about to demo. So let's see how I'm doing over here. So this is what you would get if you had Python and Tornado running on your system. And then this is where it's actually going to hang up for a second, because there's some DNS calls that are involved. So if you're not actually online, this is one of the things I should have prepared for as a speaker, but I've kind of been... I got involved in an auction, and there was a lot of hysteria right before my talk. So people are like, I'm like, what time is it? And they're like, oh, your talk's in 7 minutes. And I'm like, oh, maybe I should have started my demo or something like that. This may or may not come up in, oh, here we go. So again, we're going to have some DNS things here. I'm going to flick back over to here just in case. We'll see how this thing does. So it looks kind of like this, and then... I just did that, and then I did that, and then we're going to see something like that, and then hopefully it's going to look like something like this, and then we're going to go to here, and we can actually see what you're going to get when you download this. But I need to take a look and see how we're doing in the cooking now. Ooh, look, this is actually a web browser now, and I can see that I've got my physical map here, and then down here I kind of like... So we have like, here's our list of vulnerable hosts that might need to be patched. And then this idea about compromised hosts in the tool is like, these are not hosts that are compromised, but what I can actually do is, you know, click on the box here and say, hey, this host has been compromised. Now recalculate this impact and let me know what the power flows and what's going to happen now that the fact that this particular IP address has been compromised. And then... we have a list of all the CVE vulnerabilities found through nmap scans and Nessus and things like that, where there were some parsers that were put into the project. And all of this, again, like I said, was funded on our DOE RPE-funded project. And if I go back home, there's also, is Gabe here? Gabe Weaver. So anyway, Gabe Weaver was also on the project. He did a talk on Monday. And there's some visualizations that are CPTL-based that are put into the project where, so you want to get an idea for, and then this is another one where without the DNS it may not cook up. So let's take a quick peek because I think I probably only have 1 or 2 minutes left. Is that right, Mr. Ringmaster? And we'll see if that works out while I do a quick screenshot thing over here. Am I back up again? No, what the fuck? This button. Here we go. What's going to happen here? There might be some screenshots. So we have this idea about the CPTL visualization where we have a tree-based visualization. But again, like I said before, it's for more than just power. And then everybody's like, okay, so quick introduction. You know, this is a lightning talk. We all want to know, how do you do this shit? So... basically, I'm in online mode right now, and in order to do this following, I need to do these following steps here. So if I wanted to make my own impact files, these are like, there are instructions in the open source for how do you do this shit if you want to make your own templates for using the engine. And then there are instructions on how to do this kind of thing, and... All right, so here is where you go to get the software. And that's GitHub/BigEasy, that's me, and Armadillo. It's out there. It was released last August. There's been some improvements, maybe. And so that's the tool. And Codego is a company that was started to service the open source and provide some automated means of blah, 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 commercial stuff. So we won't get into that, but that's like, it's like for this whole model of you have an open source and then you go to the inventors of the open source to get service for the open source. And that's like Codego. And I'm kind of involved in that company with Kate Davis, who's an electrical engineer. She does all the electrical engineering stuff. And we're part of in the incubator at the University of Illinois. There's the website, and that's it. So sorry about not having a lot of time to prepare for the talk and getting whisked in here to do this. So hopefully, if there's any time for questions, if not, I'm really easy to find. I don't think that anybody will have any trouble figuring out where I might be.
I think we can take one to two questions, but let me assure you, even when Ed had 1 hour at 31Con, he didn't make it through all slides, so don't worry.
Yeah, but we got stuck on the really cool stuff that you can't film, right?
Come on. That's true.
So if you want to see that, catch me offline and maybe I'll get to show you, you know, stuff like that, but not in front of a camera. So I'll happily take questions, but I'm going to go ahead and move out of the way in deference to the next speaker, because I know he's only got 20 minutes too. I'm going to start to pack my loot up here while I'm taking questions.
Are there any questions? Would you take the microphone, please?
Yeah, so you mentioned there's a reason not to apply patches fast because people don't like downtime. So I come from telco industry and we also don't like downtime. Therefore, we asked the vendors to provide a means to hot patch the system. So I thought that idea should have come to the energy industry much, much earlier. So do you know anything about that, to put some pressure on vendors with old and crappy software?
Yes, I know a little about that. I can answer that question succinctly now and catch me afterwards for a longer answer. The power grid is as old as power. So if you can imagine, like, even here in Germany, where everything has been bombed flat a few times over the last 100 years, in America, it hasn't been bombed flat. So we have an infrastructure that in some places on the power grid is 50 years old. So if you can imagine a running machine, the largest running machine in the world that has every imaginable part in it that has been built in the last 50 years, operating with basically no tolerance for downtime. So you can't run this in parallel. There's not enough metal to replace it. So how do you decide that, oh, I'm just gonna replace this when the cost goes into the trillions of dollars to provide this kind of redundancy that you can get in the telephone network? So there's a quick answer. Catch me afterwards for maybe a wider answer on that. One more question, or is that it?
I think if you have any more questions.
Yeah, I'm easy to find, right? Okay.
We can make it, don't worry. Okay, next one is Priya, which is a colleague of mine from ERNW and a very talented young researcher. And she will talk to us about breaking VoLTE. So give a warm applause and welcome to her, please.
Yeah, I was kind of nervous, but the previous speaker really made me more relaxed, and thanks for that.
You're welcome. Yeah. You want a shot?
Shot? No.
Catch me later at the speaker party.
yeah, sure. Okay, so I'm here to talk about breaking VoLTE, or also voice over Wi-Fi, in IMS. And that's a brief content of what I'm going to talk. So there's a brief introduction and background and some experimental attacks using OpenIMS, which is an open source implementation of IMS, and some tests on the UE and conclusion. So before I get started, I'd like to thank Hendrik, who was my mentor, and also Shinjo. So this is my master thesis results, which I'm going to present here. So they were my guides. To get started, voice over LTE as well as voice over Wi-Fi are two different variants of voice over IP, where your voice gets sent over as IP packets. And at the server side, IMS, or IP multimedia subsystem, is the system that takes care of the IP packets that's coming in. This is pretty new. It was first started in 2012 in South Korea, but in Germany it came only in 2015, which is by Vodafone, which is voice over LTE, and voice over Wi-Fi is even new, that it came only on 2016. So just to get started, this is how the protocol stack would look like. I will be working only on the top layers, starting from the IP, and I don't look at the LTE or Wi-Fi, which is below that. And yeah, I am also mostly working from the UE side for these kind of tests. This is how the IMS would look like at the server side. There are components like PCSCF, ICSCF, and SCSCF. These are call session control functions. So every call session is handled by these components. And I don't want to get into the details because the time is limited. And this is like a database which has all the user identity information. So this is IMS registration process, how a phone will get registered in the network. You can see that, yeah, the components mentioned before are in place. But I'm also not going into the details of this. And also, this is how a call would look like. So SIP is Session Initiation Protocol, which is a text-based protocol which is used in making these calls. And invite, for example, is when you try to make an initial phone call, invite is the first message that gets sent to the server side. So this is how the SIP invite would look like. This is very similar to HTTP, for example. Instead of get and post, you have invite or other update or other kinds of headers in here. You can see the from and to address, and here you can find phone numbers when it's in the case of voice over LTE or Wi-Fi. So that's how it would look like. So I have some known attacks, which I simulated with the help of OpenIMS, which is an open source implementation of the IMS server. And I would like to give some examples of some attacks, what kind of attacks are possible here. But these attacks are not limited. There are much more attacks than what I'm going to talk. For performing these attacks, I need OpenIMS, which is the IMS implementation, and then SIP proxy. For one of the attacks, I use a Metasploit framework toolkit and also some clients. So this is how the SIP proxy would look like, and this is the server OpenIMS implementation. So I'm doing all these attacks just with voice over IP, not really voice over LTE or voice over Wi-Fi. But this is applicable in case of voice over Wi-Fi and voice over LTE as well. And also another thing to note here is that none of these attacks are done with IPsec. It doesn't have any IPsec involved. So the first attack is, so MSRP is a message session relay protocol. It's used for keeping a session in chats or instant messages. So all what you need to know is one of the headers. If you send a fast input in one of the packet header value, which is file selector name, this would basically crash the IMS client on the other end. So the IMS client would look like that, something similar to Skype, maybe. So if you send a fast input packet, you can find that the receiver at the other end of the call would stop working. So this was an attack by Fatty. He talked about this in Black Hat last year. And I just tried to do that the same with OpenIMS. Another kind of attack which is possible is location manipulation. So you can change this particular header So P-access network info, this header goes from the UE, and this contains information like MCC, MNC, or LAC. These basically give the location of the user. So you can just change the values in this header and just pretend that you are in another location. So as a user, you could just change your location to whatever you want. And at the server side, there was no cross-validation with HSS or with the database to actually verify if the user is in that location or not at the provider. And this can evade lawful interception techniques. And then there is another header, which basically allows to say if a user is roaming or not. And the user can actually change the header value into whatever he wants. So I just try to give something like openims fake.test. And at the server side, the actual network info is only appended to the site. So the real workflow should have been to delete this and put this in place, but the injected value always stays there. So yeah, this can basically allow the user to make his roaming call a local call and save some money. Another attack is so session initiation protocol, which I described before, is an extensible protocol. So you can add your own headers into it. So X header is one example. So you can send a hidden message as part of the header, and you don't get charged for this. So a user can do all sorts of things like this. So to have a summary, these are man-in-the-end attacks. So there is no man in the middle. The user itself is the attacker, and all these were done without IPsec. Now, this was experimental, and now I'm trying to do something with the real phones, with voice over LTE or voice over Wi-Fi in place. And these are some of the components which I require. I need VoLTE and voice over Wi-Fi enabled SIM cards. I make use of a hardware device called SimTrace, which allows me to sniff the traffic between the SIM card and the phone. And I need VoLTE and voice over Wi-Fi enabled phones. I used Samsung S6 and Samsung S7, and also Wireshark with Gcrypt library. So there are multiple interfaces which I looked into. So just like ETH1 or WLAN 0, for VoLTE we have interfaces like ARMNET 0 and ARMNET 1. And in case of voice over Wi-Fi, the packets are sent through these. I'm also looking into another interface, but I will explain about that a bit later. And also in the real phones, there is IPsec in place. So in the previous case, in experimental case, we didn't have any IPsec, but here there is integrity protection. So there is a trailer value added to each packet, which is the hash of the whole packet. So if you perform some kind of injection, the integrity value will change and you cannot really do an injection. So that's the idea of using IPsec. So this is how the packets are now. It's ESP. ESP is Encapsulated Security Protocol, which is a part of IPsec. Now, as I said before, I am performing sniffing at these interfaces, so and at the UE side of ARMNET 1 and EPDG and WLAN 0. And what I was able to see is that, first of all, none of the packets are encrypted. It is only integrity protected. And I was able to find some information disclosures in these packets. For example, I could see on the caller side the IMEI and also UTRAN cell ID, which basically gives your location information, which contains the MCC, MNC, and LAC, as I told before. And also at the callee side, that's the receiver end. You could see the IMEI of the caller, and you could also see the IMSI of the caller, which is the private identification number of the SIM card of the caller. And we also found some information leaks, like the private IP addresses of the IMS, which shouldn't be there. As the second part of the test, we performed sniffing at the SIM interface using the hardware SIM trace, which I was talking before. So that's the SIM card. We took out the SIM card and put it inside the SIM trace and connected our SIM trace to the SIM slot of the phone. And yeah, we were capturing the packets. You can see the packets like that, GSM authenticate and get response, which basically contains the IPsec keys. So I wrote a Wireshark dissector, which would help me to parse these keys and give me the CK and IK, which is the integrity key and the ciphering key, which is used in IPsec, as we saw in the ESP package before. So there is a way to check if the keys which you obtained is real or not. If the keys which you got is used in the IPsec or not. So I try to enable that, attempt to detect and decode encrypted ESP packets. So before providing the key, it would fail and say that the authentication data is false. So the key is not true. But I obtained the keys with the SIM trace, and I gave that into the Wireshark, which basically says that the IK which I obtained itself is used for the IPsec protection. So basically, these were the two tests, main tests which I did. First is sniffing at the VoLTE and VoiceOver Wi-Fi interfaces, and I could find important information disclosures. And then I also performed sniffing at the iSIM interface, and I was able to get the IK and CK, which is the IPsec keys, which is used. And we also did a validation for this, that the keys itself is used for the integrity. Previously we didn't have any IPsec at all in VoLTE or voice over Wi-Fi, but as a protection for these injection attacks, which I mentioned before, also against other attacks, we have IPsec. But then that's not really solving all the problems. Of course, it can solve an issue like an IMSI cacher or something trying doing a man in the middle, but not really man in the end attacks, because the key is also in the phone and it can be obtained by devices like SIM trace easily. So so that's what we did. So the some mitigation which you can give for the IMS providers is that never trust the UE, and also perform traffic monitoring. There should always be a deep packet inspection at the gateways, which look into each and every headers to see that if there are some fuzzing happening or if there is some kind of injection happening, and also have whitelist rules in place. And there should also be encryption to see that there are no IMSI catchers or something in between. Just authentication protection is not enough. And also user awareness not to connect into fake, suspicious Wi-Fis or, So that's it. I kind of finished on time or early. Yeah. Do you have any questions? Yeah.
Okay, so hi. Nice talk. The my question is whether the men in the middle attacks, are they going to work if I don't have if my provider is not a VoLTE or a voice over Wi-Fi provider, because I only send headers to the UE, right? Or maybe I misunderstood. Do you send the when you
Which attacks do you mean? Something like the experimental attacks which I'm talking about?
I'm talking about the man-in-the-middle attacks, the ones where you can have the IMSI and the IMEI.
Okay, yeah. We are just listening at the user end and looking at the interfaces. Mm-hmm. So I'm the receiver of your call, and I have your IMSI. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I don't even have to do anything. I just need to listen at my own interface on my side, and I get your IMSI. So yeah, it works.
So in other words, even if my provider, let's say I'm in the US and my provider does not support VoLTE or voice over Wi-Fi,
yeah,
I can still, assuming that the UE supports it, I can still attack the UE and get the IMSI and the IMEI.
No, because it may not be using session initiation protocol. I have looked only into the SIP packets, but yeah, not if there is, yeah.
No, let's assume that I install my own like OpenIMS or whatever. I'm having like a fake IMS server.
Yeah.
Is it possible to attack the UE?
So it shouldn't be there. The IMSI shouldn't be sent to the receiver end. That's the proper way to implement it. But I could see that in the real providers, which is happening. So if it's not implemented that way, you are safe. Yeah.
Any more questions?
Hello, thanks for really good research. This has been interesting to listen to. While you were testing this, did you see if the IPsec link had replay protection turned on for the security association?
No. I don't know how to check that.
I think it's in the negotiation for the security association, like on the ESA KMP. I think it's noted somewhere.
Yeah.
The different. When I've been looking at this, I have never seen it turn on for some reason. I mean, it's probably costly to keep a table of the sequence number of all IPsec connections.
Okay.
But what it means if it's turned off is that you can replay voice, and that can mean a difference if someone says yes or no in a conversation, if you are a man in the middle.
Do you mean looking at the sequence number?
Yeah, the sequence number in the given ESP packet.
Okay.
No pressure. Awesome work. Thank you.
Yeah.
Then thank you very much, Priya.
Yeah. Thank you.